Aloha. Guys, I said aloha. Aloha, everyone. Hey, praise God from whom all blessings flow. It's a beautiful sunny day here in the park, yeah? And the Bible says when two or three are gathered, Jesus is in our midst. Amen? You guys, me. What's your name again, brother? Mark? Richard? Yeah, me, Richard, and brother, your brother, name. Ready to praise God, okay? You have your music shared, yeah? Forever. Forever. We give thanks to the Lord forever and ever, yeah? No holding back. When you sing these praises, you better sing it from your heart because we give thanks to the Lord. Amen?
Check. Oh,
where is this?
There it is.
Is it done?
Hello?
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Maybe he put it on.
Thank you.
It's all about you that we're here. Thank you, Jesus. You're very much welcome in this place right now. When two or three are gathered, you are in our midst. Sweet. Yes. in our lifetime, Lord. We were always lost, but now, Lord, you came to us. You died for us and saved us from our sins, Lord. We have been found by you. Amen. You're not blind anymore, because if you receive God, if you call in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are saved. Amen.
Praise God. All right. Praise God. Hello, everyone. I'm so glad you're here. If you're ready to get in the Word of God, I know the Holy Spirit is going to speak life into you today, because if you feel like you're coming here, oh, man, there's a lot of things going on. Maybe you got some stress. You got some anxiety. Well, let me tell you, you're in the right place, because God can take that all away. As you listen to his word, as you just embrace his holy presence, we know Father God fills us with more of his love, his peace, and his joy. Amen? Why don't we go ahead? Let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time as we come with minds and hearts that are fully submitted to you. I pray that you will have your way, Father. Speak to us in such ways that we know we're not going to leave here the same person. We know we're becoming more and more like Jesus Christ as we surrender our hearts to you. Father, we love you so much. We praise your most holy name. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray all of these things. And all my brothers, we say together, amen. Praise God and praise God. Well, if you take a look at your notes today, the title of our sermon is Approaching Father God. Approaching Father God. You know, I got to tell you, over the many years of my life, I had my share of many different bosses or managers at my places of work. I'm sure you probably had a lot of managers and bosses in your life, right? Some were very friendly. Some were very helpful and kind. Well, some were really darn right mean, arrogant, and obnoxious. You had your share of bosses like that? You know, the ones that were really good-natured were extremely approachable, and while the ones that were ill-natured, wow, they were scary. And you didn't want to approach them in fear that you might get your head bitten off. You ever experienced that? Where you can go to the boss and say, oh, excuse me, I have a question. Why? What's the problem now? I thought you got everything under control. Why? What's going on? What did you do wrong now? Wow. I tell you, you don't want to have that kind of boss. Because I got to tell you, I had a boss kind of like that. And that's why my wife told me there are nights I'll be grinding my teeth because I was so stressed out. But you know, the ones that were super nice, man, those are the ones that helped you along the way. It helped you grow as a person and as a professional, right? As they were willing to help you in any way they could help you. And you know, in our relationship with God, you know, some believers may say that when they go into the presence of God, they feel God is very approachable and they feel completely relaxed and at ease. They love being in the presence of God, knowing that God is so approachable. While others may feel extremely fearful and anxious in the presence of God. I heard people say they picture God as a grumpy old man with lightning in his fists, ready to hurl this lightning bolt because you done wrong, right? And sometimes we see it in the cartoons. I think that's where people get the idea. Like I seen it in Tom and Jerry, you know, the cat and the mouse. They portray God like that. And that's why people get this image of God being like that. And some people may believe that God is unapproachable because of their false belief that God is an angry God who loves to punish and destroy everyone. They believe that God is against human beings. Oh, where did you get that kind of idea, you know? But if they knew the scriptures, they would know that this is far from the truth. So we're going to look in the Word of God today, and we're going to discover what is truth about the very fact that we know we have a God that is so approachable and that He loves us so very much. Amen? Well, let's look at that question there. What can we do as believers to make God much more approachable in our lives? Well, let's look at number one here. It says, we must enter His presence with a strong spirit of what? Humility. And you guys hear me talk about humility a lot, right? And it's so important because that's one of the key characteristics that we must possess as a Christian. Because you don't have humility, man, you're not going to represent Christ well. That's all I got to say. Okay, so that's why it's so important. We got to be humble in spirit. And the more we can humble ourselves in the sight of God and of man, right, the more we can enter in His holy presence with greater ease. It's about humbling yourself. Look what it says here in James 4:6. I want you to read that with me. Ready? Go. But He gives us what? More grace. That is why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but He shows favor to who? To the humble. Okay, you want God to oppose you? Well, we know it tells us right here, God opposes the proud. So if you're prideful at heart, God, He will oppose you. But if you are humble, He will show you great favor. And I got to tell you, I find it almost true in every type of competition, whether it be game of chess or boxing or, you know, cooking, you know, or, yeah, even a spelling bee, okay? Usually it's the cocky, arrogant one that loses disgracefully. And, you know, the humble one is honored with a great victory. And you might have seen this on YouTube, right? Where two boxers, you know, the one is like sticking his fists out at the opponent. I'm going to knock you out. You just wait. You're going to get knocked out. You're going to be put to sleep. And guess who really gets put to sleep, right? I see that all the time. And, you know, the arrogant, cocky one usually is the one who ends up losing. And the one who is humble, gentle, kind, meek, mild-mannered, they're always the one, seems to be, at least, they're risen to the top. And I know, for me at least, I see God has something to do with it. He looks for people that are humble at heart. Amen? And look what it says here in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 to 7. Read that with me. Ready? Go. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at a proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because why? He cares for you. So, how do we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God? Well, let me tell you, you know, for some Christian athletes, you ever seen some of them, you know, football, basketball players? They love to give God all the glory, you know? A sportscaster may go up to them and say, wow, you just won the championship. How did you do it? And they just raise their hand and say, glory to God. It's because of my Father God that I have this victory. And you can see a lot of times, right, the newscaster is like, oh, let's cut off to something else, you know? And they don't like to hear that. They want them to say, hey, because, yeah, all the hard training, all the effort. I love it when Christian athletes say, it's because of my Lord Jesus Christ. And I look at them and I go, wow, they keep winning victory after victory because guess what? They're giving glory to God. I'm going to tell you, the more you give glory to God, you're going to see more victory, you're going to see more successes in your very own life. I believe that with all my heart because it seems like the more humble I am, oh, God really brings really more of those successes in my life. And I praise God for all of that, you know. And with their genuine humility, they take the focus off of themselves, right? And they put it all on God. They don't want to, you know, hear people say, oh, yeah, you're the best. You are the champion. You are the best of the best. No, they always point back to God. And that's what we should do too. You know, the Apostle Paul, he was one who did this. You know, though he was known to be one of the greatest leaders, you know, of the Christian faith, and he was also known as the father of the apostles, right? This is what he had said about himself. In 1 Corinthians 15, 9, he says, you know what he says? I am the least of the apostles. He didn't say, I am the best, I am the most. No, I am the least of the apostles. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8, Apostle Paul, he says, I am the very least of all the saints. The very least? In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, he says, I am the foremost. I am the worst of sinners. Wow. You know, everyone looked to him as being such a great leader of the church. Yet he's saying all these things about himself. Did he have low self-esteem? What's wrong with him, right? No, he was showing humility. And he didn't want everyone to kind of put him on a pedestal because he wants all eyes to go on who? Go on Jesus. And that's why he accomplished so many great things. It's because of his passion to put Jesus Christ first. Amen? And you know, in order for us to be convicted of our sins, we need to have a humble spirit to be led by the Holy Spirit of God. You don't have a humble spirit, you're not going to want to listen to what the Holy Spirit has to say. And when the Word of God speaks to you, that's not for me. That's for my wife, right? My wife needs to hear that, not me. I'm perfect. And we laugh at that, but I got to tell you, I heard people tell me, Pastor Ben, since I became a Christian, I am perfect. If you're perfect, you don't need to come to church because you don't need Jesus Christ, right? I need Jesus Christ because I know I am imperfect. You can ask my wife. I make mistakes all the time, right? But I always make it right with the Lord. Amen? That's the key. I need Jesus Christ as my Savior. He saves me from myself. Amen? And I realize I'm becoming more like Him as I tune in to the Holy Spirit's voice. Look what it says here in Psalm 25, verses 8 through 10. Read that with me. Ready? Go. The Lord is good and does what is right. He shows the proper path to those who go astray. He leads who? The humble in doing right, teaching them his way. The Lord leads with unfailing love and faithfulness all who keep his covenant and obey his demands. Wow. Why does it say that he leads the humble in doing right? Why not lead the prideful in doing right? Like I said, they probably won't listen, right? The prideful says, no, I got to answer better than that, right? Even though it's like from the Bible. I said, the Bible says this. Oh, but I think I got something even better, Pastor Ben. You got something better than the Word of God? Really? That's where pride comes in. So when we humble ourselves, say, yeah, you know what? I'm going to listen to the Word of God. And that's why God says this, right? He leads the humble in doing right. And that's why we got to humble ourselves and realize as we listen to the Word of God, you're going to be blessed in every way. Can I hear amen to that? And that is the truth. And we know God, He will do that. And if we are not possessing a humble spirit, we are more inclined to do things our own way. And when we are humble before God, though, we delight Him. We make God happy when we are humble in spirit and we just want to just do everything that He asks of us, right? And we know, guess what God will do? God will bless us in ways you never imagine. I want you to look at this scripture here in Psalm 149, verses 4 to 5. I want you to read that with me. Ready? Go. For the Lord delights in his people. He crowns the humble with what? Victory. Let the faithful rejoice that he honors them. Let them sing for joy as they lie on their beds. I want to say that verse again. He crowns the humble with what? Victory. And that's why that humble boxer will knock out that prideful, arrogant, cocky boxer that thinks that he'll put him to sleep, right? I believe God has something to do with it. It's that humility spirit that gives you power. And here, amen. That gives you wisdom. That will give you great success as you continue to do things God's way. Amen. I want you to get point number two now. It says there, we must enter his presence with great what? Confidence. You know, oftentimes some believers believe, you know what, they're not worthy to be called a child of God. You know, maybe they have sin in their life, or they just feel like, oh, I don't know, I keep making mistakes, so I don't know if I have the confidence to approach God, because God may not like me. You know, God may hurl a lightning bolt right at me if I come into his presence. I'm going to tell you, don't believe that. Our Father God loves you so much. He loves it when his child says, Papa God, I need you. Help me. He's right there and say, okay, I'm right here, child. I'm right here. I'm going to shower you with my love. That's our Father God. That's what he will do. And, you know, sometimes people, they believe they cannot experience God's goodness and his holy presence simply because they feel they are not worthy. No, you put your faith in Christ, you are worthy, because he knows your heart. He knows your longing for him, and he's waiting for you to spend time with him. I want you to look what it says here in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 to 16. Read that with me. Ready? Go. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So what do? Let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we'll find grace to help us when we need it the most. And so, you know, Jesus, he is God. He came down in the form of a baby child. And, you know, he suffered pain. Yeah, he knew what it is like to suffer as a human being. So he understands. And so that's why it tells us you can come boldly into the throne room of mercy and grace where our Father God is, because he understands. He knows of the pain that we can go through in life. But God says, come, fellowship with me, because I long to be with you. And as you humble yourself before him, guess what? You're going to experience the fullness of God's love, his peace, his joy. He's going to shower you with his holy presence. You know, I got to tell you, I remember seeing a photograph of President John F. Kennedy sitting at his desk in the Oval Office at the White House while his kids, they were playing on the floor at his feet. And you see little John, right? John Jr. He's like hiding, you know, in his desk. And, you know, it's so cute, right? It's a picture of the son and the daughter. And, you know, they're free to come and go as they please. You got to understand, no one is usually allowed to go in the Oval Office. You know, they usually have to go through a strict security clearance. But guess what? Not the kids. Why? Because they are his kids, right? So they just go in and out. They're laughing. They're doing whatever they want. You know, they need a glass of water or a snack, you know. John F. Kennedy will not tell his security guard, oh, we'll get my kid a glass of water. Who will do it? He will, right? Or he'll get a potato, bag of potato chips for them if they wanted it. Why? Because they are his kids. Guess what? Same thing. Our Father God. We come into his throne room. He knows, Father God knows that we belong to him. How does he know this? Because we put faith in his son, Jesus Christ. We have received Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Therefore, we are worthy to enter that throne room. Not because of what we did or what we said so much. It's what we had expressed deep within our hearts, that we believe in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So just like those kids, yeah, we can enter in. It says boldly enter in to that throne room of mercy and grace, where you will find the holy presence of God. Amen. I want you to look what it says here in Mark 11, 23 to 24. Look what it says here. Read it with me. Ready? Go. Truly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, It will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in what? In prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Okay? Just like the children of John F. Kennedy, right? They would go to him, ask for whatever they want. Dad, can I have a candy bar? I'm sure if he had one, he would give it to them, right? Or a cup of water, whatever it may be. Same thing with us. You know, when we know our hearts truly belong to Father God, yeah, he looks to us as his princes and princesses, all right? Because, yeah, we have royalty in us because he's the king, right? Father God is the King Almighty. And therefore, as princes and princesses, right, our Father God wants to shower us with his goodness. So don't think in your mind, oh, I'm not worthy. No, just know as a child of God, because your heart belongs to him, you can go boldly into that throne room and say, Papa God, I love you so much. Amen? I want you to look at point number three now. It says there, enter into his presence with a heart of what? Repentance. Look what it says there in Jeremiah chapter 15, verses 19 to 20. And this is what God had said to the Israelites, right? His people. Read it with me. Ready? Go. This is how the Lord responds. If you return to me, I will restore you so that you can continue to what? To serve me. If you speak good words rather than worthless ones, you will be my spokesman. You must influence them. Do not let them influence you. They will fight against you like an attacking army, but I will make you as secure as a fortified wall of bronze. They will not conquer you, for I am with you to protect and rescue you. I, the Lord, have spoken. And this is God talking to the Israelites saying, hey, you have strayed far from me, but come back to me because I want to bless you. I want my goodness to shine forth in your life. And what God is asking them to do is to repent. That means to make a U-turn. You may be heading on a path of great destruction because the devil may have gotten you there. And he's telling you to keep going forward because he wants you destroyed. But you must know the Holy Spirit of God that is in you. He will continually lead you back on track. He's always going to be speaking to you. If you're way off course, the Holy Spirit is right there saying, come this way, child. Don't go that direction. You got a choice to make. That's why God says, repent, turn from your sins, and I will bless you. And when we truly have a heart to turn from our sins, God will do his part to clean up all the messes that we have made in our lives. And, you know, he's going to restore us to what we were before. But you know what? We're going to be even better. When God is in the business of restoring a person's life, it always ends up being way better. Now, God, he knows what to do, and he will bring forth his goodness if you continue to do things his way. Amen? And we know that's why it's so important. We got to have a repentive heart. And you want to be just having a strong relationship with the Lord. Every single day, you go to God and you confess of your sins. Even though you think you've done no wrong, you just say, Lord, show to me. If I've said something wrong to my loved one or whatever it may be, Lord, reveal it to me. And I want to confess it. I want to repent of it. I'm going to tell you, you do that every day. And truly, you go to God with that kind of heart. You're going to see your life change. God's going to change you from the inside out. And you're going to see God's goodness being showered in your life. I'm telling you, I've seen it in my own life because I used to be kind of arrogant before, right? God changed my heart. God softened my heart. And God made me who I am today is because I chose to do things his way. And you got to understand, if there is no repentance, there is no pardon. God will not pardon you of your sins if you do not repent. You know, some years ago, there was this murderer that was sentenced to death, okay? And the murderer's brother, to whom the state was deeply indebted for his former service in the FBI, he besought the governor of the state for his brother's pardon, okay? And the governor knew about this man, right? So he said, okay, I will pardon your brother. He granted the pardon. And the man, he visited his brother with the pardon in his pocket. And he asked his brother, so I just wanted to know, brother, what would you do if you received a pardon? In other words, to leave this prison cell, right? Because he is sentenced to death. And he told him, he says, you know, I tell you the truth. You know what I'm going to do? The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to track down that judge who sentenced me. I'm going to murder him. And the next thing I will do is I'm going to track down that chief witness and murder him also. Oh, right? So the brother, he just got up from his chair. And guess what? He left the prison with the pardon in his pocket. He said, I'm not going to let you go free so that you can kill other people, right? And because of what this man had done, death penalty had been waiting on him. And, you know, the thing is, the opportunity was granted to him, right? That pardon was granted to him. But guess what? He did not choose to repent. And because he wasn't willing to repent, guess what? There could be no pardon. And that's the thing we got to understand. You want to be in the fullness of God's presence. You got to have a repentant heart each and every day. It's not just a one-time thing. You can say, oh, I said the sinner's prayer. Isn't that good enough? I just repented that one time. That's all it takes, right? No, each and every day. The Bible talks about this. It's called a contrite heart. A contrite heart, God will not despise. A contrite heart means you're always going to God and saying, Lord, I'm so sorry for what I've done. If I messed up in any way, please help me. Show me what I need to do to make things better. Amen? And before you say, oh, but Pastor Ben, isn't the unbeliever the one that needs to repent? We as believers, we don't need to repent. No. That's not true. No, each and every day we are to have a repentant heart. I want you to look what it says here in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 16 to 18. Read that with me. Ready? Go. But it is no shame to suffer for being a Christian. Praise God for the privilege of being called by his name. For the time has come for what? For judgment, and it must begin with who? God's household. And if God's judgment begins with us, what terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's good news? And also, if the righteous are, what does it say there? Barely saved. What will happen to godless sinners? Wow! These are powerful scripture verses here. Let's go through them very quickly here. It says here, the time has come for judgment. Judgment from whom? From God, right? Because of sin, right? And that's why the Bible says God's wrath is coming upon the world, right? And it tells us it must begin with God's household. Who is God's household? Us, the believers, not the unbelievers that are in the world. Because even as believers, do we sin? Yeah, we do. Don't ever say you're without sin, because that's not the truth. The Bible says you say you're without sin, the truth is not in you. You deceived yourself. The devil has deceived you, okay? We are our sinners, but we are made right in the very eyes of God. Amen? And it tells us, if judgment begins with us, what terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's news, God's good news? And also, if the righteous are barely saved. Wow, you think about that. Some people say, oh, I'm saved. I'm beyond saved because I am such a good person. Really? It says here, we are barely saved. Because you know what? The fact of the matter is, we are saved not because of what we had done. It's because of what Jesus did for us on that cross. Amen? It's what he did that we are saved by his grace, his mercy, his love. We are saved. And knowing this, are you going to live a life that is fully devoted to him? Or are you just going to say, oh, it's all about me. I just want to live life how I want to live it. No, you live your life fully surrendered to the very one who gave your life, who gave who gave his life for you. Amen. And as you do this, wow, I'm going to tell you, you're going to experience the wonderful presence of God like you never experienced before. When you realize this life is not about you anymore, it's all about him. Amen. Well, let's look at the last one here. Number four, enter into his presence with what? With much what? Gratitude in our hearts. And I got to tell you, you want to make God very approachable in your life? Be thankful. But sometimes I hear people say, I got nothing to be thankful about. There's not even one thing? No, nothing. Come on. You know, because if you really believe and see why you're so miserable. Look what it says here in Psalm 100, 4-5. Look what the psalmist says there. Read it with me. Ready? Go. Enter his gates with what? Thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever. And his faithfulness continues to each generation. Wow. And, you know, you just read that and you realize that the psalmist, he got so much joy in his heart. Why? Because he has a thankful heart. And if you kind of wonder what, you know, sometimes you think, how come I'm always like in a bad mood? How come I'm always feeling sad and I feel depressed and all? Well, ask yourself, do you have a thankful heart? Because I'm going to tell you, oftentimes that's what it takes, a thankful heart to just be rid of all the depression, all the anxiety that may be in your life. It's when you thank God for everything that you have in your life. Look what it says in Colossians 3:16. I want you to read that with me. Ready? Go. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through what? Psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to who? To God. With gratitude in our hearts. Think about this. When was the last time you sang to God with gratitude in your heart? I mean, just expressing so much joy for what God has done for you in your life. If you've never done that, I want to tell you, try it. Just sing a song of praise to God. I'm going to tell you, you're going to feel so much better for one thing, but you're going to realize, yeah, I got so much to be thankful for. And, you know, whether you have very much or very little, right, having a heart of gratitude will bring forth the presence of God in your life, and it will make him very approachable. You know, I'm going to read to you this literary piece that was written by an anonymous person, and it is called What I Am Thankful For. Just listen to this, okay? It says here, I am thankful for the taxes I pay because it means I am I am thankful for the clothes that fit a little too snug because it means I have enough to eat. I'm thankful for my shadow who watches me work because it means I am out in the sunshine. I'm thankful for a lawn that needs mowing, windows that need cleaning, and gutters that need fixing because it means I have a home. I'm thankful for the spot that I find at the far end of the parking lot because it means I am capable of walking. I am thankful for my huge heating bill because it means I am kept warm. I am thankful for all the complaining I hear about our government because it means that we have freedom of speech. I am thankful for the lady behind me in the church who keeps singing off key because it means I can still hear. I am thankful for the piles of laundry and ironing because it means my loved ones are nearby. I am thankful for the alarm that goes off in the early morning hours because it means that I am alive. I'm thankful for the weariness and the aching muscles that I have at the end of the day because it means that I have been productive. And he says here, the art of thanksgiving, it is gratitude in action. It is thanking God for the gift of life by living it triumphantly and victoriously. Wow. And sometimes, you know, we only want to be thankful when, okay, we get exactly what we want. We want that nice, red, shiny sports car in the garage, right? I don't got that. I got nothing to be thankful for. Wow. Talk about spoiled brattiness, right? And we realize when we have a humble heart, no, we just thank God for the simple things that we have in life. Amen? The food that we have on the table, the very fact we have clothing that can clothe us. I mean, all these things, right? We take for granted. But we realize in a lot of, you know, especially third world countries, man, every day they're suffering. They're totally without. And so, yeah, be thankful for the simple things in life. And thank God for what you do have right now. And if you just think about it, if you can make a list, you just tonight you decide, okay, I'm just going to take out a pen and a paper. I'm just going to list 10 things that I'm thankful for. You know, maybe you want to start out with 5, okay? For some people who just can't think more than that, you know? And then after that, tomorrow, maybe 10, 15, 20. I'm going to tell you, it's going to get easier and easier. The more you have a grateful heart, man, more things you're going to have to thank God for in your life. And suddenly, I'm going to tell you, you're going to come back to me. I almost guarantee it. You're going to come back to me and go, wow, Pastor Ben, I got so much joy in my heart. I don't know what to do with it. It's because you have a grateful heart. That is the power of having a grateful heart. Amen? And I got to tell you, it only gets better and better. I want you to look at this scripture, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 17 to 19. I want you to read that with me. Ready? Go. Never stop praying. Be thankful in what? All circumstances, for this is God's will for who? For you and for me who belong to Christ Jesus. Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Be thankful only when things go your way, right? Be thankful when you get what you want, right? He says in all circumstances. Does that mean also the bad? Yes. Can you be really thankful for the bad things that happen in your life? Yeah, you can. You just say, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I know I don't understand why I'm going through what I'm going through, but Lord, I know you're with me. I'm thankful. I know you will get me through this. And I praise you for that. In all circumstances, give thanks unto the Lord. Because why? It tells us because this is God's will for you and for me. If you say you belong to Jesus, yeah, it should be something you should do. This is God's will for us who belong to Christ Jesus. And it says, do not stifle the Holy Spirit. What does it mean to stifle? It means to extinguish. Do not extinguish the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. And we can extinguish it when we're not thankful. I want you to understand that. When we're not grateful, when we're always like shaking our fists at God, when we're always like, Lord, why aren't you doing anything? We're complaining. Right? Because that's the opposite of having a grateful heart. You're always complaining. You ever been around someone who loves to complain? I mean, that's the thing, right? When you're always complaining, you have no joy. You have no peace. And that's why you're always miserable. So just try this. Just have a grateful heart and see how it will change your attitude. Amen? Let's go to the bottom line verses now. Let's look at the first one here. I'm sure you are familiar with this. Jeremiah 29, verses 11 to 14. I want you to read it with me. Ready? Go. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will what? I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with what? All of your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. You can see in these verses, right? God says, you're looking for me? Ain't hard. I love it when my child seeks after me. Because he isn't hard to find. Believe me, brothers and sisters, he isn't hard to find. Sometimes it's just simply calling on the name of Jesus from deep within your heart. And suddenly you feel a sweet, loving presence come upon you. I experienced this before, where there are times when I'm just experiencing great sorrow, you know, just misery in my life. And all I can say is, Jesus, I need you. And sometimes just simply saying that, I just feel God's love. I feel his power. I feel his presence coming right into me. And he's telling me, child, I'm right here. I'm going to help you through this. Don't worry. I'm going to help you through it. That's what we need to do. Just go to him with this kind of heart. It says, with all of your heart, right? Seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And it tells us, I will be found by you. He guarantees it. He loves it when we seek after him. And when he shows himself, suddenly, you know, you're not going to understand it. You're going to feel such peace. You're going to feel a peace like you've never experienced before. The Bible says this is a peace that surpasses all understanding. You're not going to understand why you're experiencing so much peace at that moment. But you know what? You know it is the very presence of God, because he is so approachable. He will tell you, oh, I just love it when you come and spend time with me, when you call on my name. And in this last scripture here, in 2 Chronicles 7:14, I'm sure you're familiar with this too. Why don't we read it together? Ready? Go. If my people who are called by my name will what? Humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Wow. And it's pretty much, this is everything in a nutshell what we just talked about in this sermon. You see this? Humble ourselves and we pray. We start talking to God. We start fellowshipping with him. We seek his face and we turn. We repent from our wicked ways. Guess what God will do? He will hear us from heaven and he will forgive our sin and he will heal us and he will heal our land. Amen. So remember this, brothers and sisters, just like how a father is so glad to see, you know, his child, maybe for whatever reason, he hasn't seen this child for a long time. You can just imagine. And let's say in the military, right? You've seen in the video, you too, right? Where the father comes home, the children are like, Daddy, you're home, right? And the wife is like, what are you doing back? Sometimes it's a surprise, right? And you see so much joy, so much love, right? And I got to tell you, that's the same thing with our Father God. You got to get this in your mind. That is the same kind of emotion that God shows to us when we are willing to spend time with him. When he sees us, he is so overjoyed. And the same with us. We should be so overjoyed when we are in the presence of our Father God. Amen? Praise God. Why don't we go ahead and let's bow our heads, let's bow our hearts, let's come before our Father in heaven. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time. And Father, we just know, Lord, as we just heard your words, we heard the scriptures that you have written, Lord, that you have inspired in the hearts of man. Father, we know that sometimes for some people, they may believe that you are unapproachable, that you are not for them, that you are against them. Father, wherever they have received this life, Father, we rebuke in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray, Lord, that they will truly understand, according to your word, you love to be in the presence of your children. And Father, forgive us for those times when we haven't made any effort in trying to draw close to you. Because your word tells us, draw close to God, and he will draw close to you. And right now, with all our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, I've been a Christian for some time, whether it be like a few years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, maybe 20 years. You may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, sometimes I just feel like I just am not worthy to receive the goodness of God, that I'm not worthy to go into his presence. I'm going to tell you, stop believing that lie. No, he loves to be with you because you belong to him. You are the child of God because you put your faith in his son, Jesus Christ. And And right now, if you feel that in your heart that, yeah, I'm not going to believe that lie anymore, I'm going to say, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I can spend time with you. I want to spend more time with you. And you're just expressing to God that you desire him. If this is truly your heart's desire, with all our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, can you raise your hand right now and say, that's me, so I can pray for you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anyone else saying, yes, Jesus, that is me? Hallelujah. I see your hands. I see your hands. Praise God. Anyone else? I see your hand. I see your hand. Praise God. Praise God. I see your hand. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right. You can put your hands down. Let's pray. Father, you've seen all the hands that were raised, but most importantly, it's the hearts behind those very hands saying, Lord, please forgive me when I had thought these kinds of thoughts, but no more. I'd love to be in your holy presence, Lord. That's what I want to tell you right now. And I pray, Father, as we spend more time together, I pray, Lord, your holy presence will be magnified in my life. And I pray, as this is truly the prayer of all my brothers and sisters' hearts, I pray your will intensify your holy presence in their lives. Father, we love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone says, amen, amen. And now for some of you, you may be saying, you know, Pastor Ben, I'll be honest, I haven't received Christ in my life. I've heard the message spoken before, but I keep putting it off. But I'm going to tell you, no one is guaranteed another tomorrow. The truth of the matter is, you must know Jesus Christ today. The Bible says, if you don't know him now, today, if you were to take your last and final breath on this planet Earth, do you know where you will be going? Because the Bible tells us our spirit and soul will be in the presence of God if you know his son, Jesus Christ. If not, the Bible also tells us you'll be forever separated from the love of Christ. So right now, if you know the Holy Spirit is tugging at your heart to make a decision to say, yes, I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Don't put it off anymore, brothers and sisters, because as soon as you do, you say yes to Jesus Christ, you will be welcomed into the family of God. And the very arms of our Lord Jesus Christ will embrace you. And if this is your heart's desire, you're saying yes to Jesus with all of your heart, can you just raise your hand and say, that's me, I'm saying yes to Jesus Christ. Can you just raise your hand and say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Praise God. Yes, Lord. With all of my heart, I want to belong to you. Hallelujah. Anyone else? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. All right. Hallelujah. You can put your hands down. Praise Jesus. I want you to say this prayer with me. Pray it out loud. And even though you are a believer already, just say these very words as you know that you're reciting what you believe about our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you did raise your hand for the first time in receiving Christ, please pray in your heart, because our Father God, he is listening. And if you are serious about this prayer, just watch. I'm going to tell you, just watch what God will do. He's going to bring so much goodness of his goodness into your life. Just repeat these very words. Say, Father God, I need you. I give you praise for who you are. I believe in you. I believe in your son, Jesus Christ. Died for me on the cross.
Died for me on the cross.
But on the third day, he rose again. And he lives inside of my heart. I give you praise for that. And Father God, I confess that I'm a sinner. But your word says, if I confess of my sins, you're faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Cleanse me now, Lord. Make me holy and pure unto you. So now I say this, Lord, so you can hear me, so everyone can hear me, so that the devil will know that Jesus Christ is my Lord, that I live for him, I live for him only. Father God, I thank you, for you have written my name in your Lamb's Book of Life. I will spend eternity with you forever. It's in the name of Jesus Christ I pray. And everyone says, amen. Amen. Praise God. Clap out, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.